We're going to get started here in just a second, but welcome to you. Welcome to you. If you're a guest of ours here at Midway, we are certainly indeed glad to have you if you are a guest of ours, and would hope that you would allow us to get to know you after the service is over. When you came in this morning, you should have picked up a communion packet. If you failed to do that or forgot to do that, we do have a couple of young men here. All you have to do at this time is raise your hand, and they will come to you and bring you a packet if you forgot to pick one up. Remember also that if you have a cell phone on you, make sure that you have muted it or put it on vibrate so that there is no disturbance during our worship service. Those men that will be assisting with our worship service this morning, Grant Addison has stepped in at the last second he's going to be leading our singing. Kelly and Megan are on their way to the hospital. Kelly was scheduled to lead singing, but Grant's going to take his place this morning. Brother Ed Griffith will lead us in our opening prayer. Tommy Ayers will head the table and when it comes time for us to assemble around the table. And to close us out, Terry Ford will close us out, and the appropriate time, Mark Howell, the preacher here at Midway, will bring us the lesson of the hour. Let's go ahead at this time and get started, and we'll let Grant come up and lead us in our opening song.
Heavenly Father, we're thankful unto Thee for the blessings we have in life. We're especially thankful today that we can meet and assemble together such as we are. Help us to put aside the things that we've faced this morning, the things of the world. Help us to devote our time solely to Thee as we sit and listen to Your Word that is presented to us so eloquently by Mark Howe. We pray for those leaders that lead this church. Pray that they continue to lead us in a way that would grow, multiply, and help us to reach that heavenly land, that home in heaven someday. We're thankful for Your great love for us. Help us to always be mindful what You did for us, and especially giving Your Son that He shed His blood, redeeming us from our sins. And all You asked is us to follow Your ways, Your teachings. And we're thankful He not only gave us a way to go to heaven by forgiving our sins, but He left a roadmap for us that we can study and meditate upon and help us to defend ourselves against the devil and his forces. Help us to be strong as we walk each day, watch our words, what we say, and how we react to other people. Help us to always be mindful to forgive, to be thankful, and to praise you. We ask that you be with us as we go into this service, that we'll be able to listen and meditate on your word and hopefully take the things that we learned this day to help us to further guide us in our directions that we've set for ourselves by choosing to be a Christian. We pray for those that have been mentioned as sick, suffering the afflictions of this world. I especially pray for Brother Joe Nichols and the problems he's having with past surgery and his affliction. Heavenly Father, we pray that you'll be with him, that you will strengthen him, for he is definitely a great soldier in your cause. We're thankful that he sets a great direction for each of us, an example to follow. And may we each set an example that others may look to us and want to follow you. We pray that those that have gone through hardship to be here this day, that you especially think of them, and may they find it in their heart that they see that it's worthwhile, the struggle they went through. We realize that you put struggles before us to humble us, to cause us to see that your love for us is far greater than we can have the imagination to ever think how great you really are. We ask that you be with us as we go through life. Be with us through the remainder of this service. Pray for our elders, our deacons, and each member that's here. For this we give thanks in Christ our Savior's name. Amen.
Oh. morning. It's so good to see everyone here today. So thankful that you're present. You know, last Sunday, Kelly preached from the floor, and one of the things that we wanted to do, you know, sort of like this, if you can't beat them, join them. Always ask folks to move up, and folks don't like moving up, so what do? Well, we move back to you. And so hopefully everybody, it's just more able to communicate, feel a little closer to everybody. And so we're doing this for the time being, at least. And we want you to be able to express your thoughts and opinions in regard to that. As we begin our lesson this morning, I want you to think about a guy that we'll just simply call Hank. Now, Hank's a good old Southern boy. He works at a small factory here in the South. The man who owns the factory is a man by the name of Fredrickson. He has a foreman, Hank does, by the name of Buckley. Now, Hank is one of these guys that when it comes time to go to work, he gets there right on time, or maybe just a couple of minutes after time for you to start. Now, you understand what I'm talking about. Old Hank is one of these guys that throughout the day, when it comes to work, he's not looking for any extra. As a matter of fact, he finds every opportunity that he can to avoid taking on any other responsibility that he might be offered. He's one of these guys that always takes his breaks and sometimes more breaks in between. And so you begin to get the picture of the kind of guy that we're talking about. The work that he does is the mirror image, if you will, of his lackadaisical attitude toward things. It's not real good to begin with, and it's getting worse. He's sort of like a child. You know, a child will test the limits. They'll test your limits about things to just see just how far they can go. And when they do that, as you know, they want to find out what their perimeters are so that they'll be able to stay within the perimeters, but they want to get just as close to the edge as they possibly can. And old Hank is one of these grown-up children, as we might put it, and so he's always testing the limits. Now, I've got a question for you. If you've ever been out in the workplace and worked in public work or something of that nature, some kind of thing like that, how many of you have ever worked with Hank? Anybody ever worked with Hank? Hank is one of these guys that as his attitude and his actions play out in the workplace, he makes everybody's job more difficult. That's just the kind of guy he is. He makes everybody's job more difficult because he really doesn't want to hold up his end. And he really is trying to do just as little as he can to get by. And so everybody else has to step up. Everybody else has to fill in for him in order to make things go the way that they should and make sure that things are taken care of. Now, Buckley, again, the foreman, tried his best to get Hank to step it up. He was doing everything he can. He talked to him. He tried to encourage him. He tried to help him. He did everything he can to try to step up. But one day, Buckley called him into his office. And he explained to Hank, he said, Hank, he said, Mr. Fredrickson has called me and told me he's taken notice of you and what you've done. And he wanted me to call you in and talk to you specifically. And he wanted me to tell you that you are going to have to step it up, that you're going to have to make some changes in your life. And as they were having their discussion, Hank's reply to what Buckley had said to him sort of stunned Hank, or stunned Buckley. His abject honesty was something that just really took Buckley aback. You know what Hank said? Hank said this. He said, hey man, I don't see the point of exerting myself or going above and beyond. As long as I'm meeting the bare minimum requirements, what's the problem? Now, I'm going to leave you to let that mull over in your brain for a while. We'll come back to Hank a little bit later in the lesson. But I want you to think about it. I want you to keep that there in the forefront of your mind as we continue on in our lesson today. Now, sort of changing gears right here. Still thinking about Hank. Keep him up here now. Don't lose him. But let's change gears a little bit. I want to talk for a little while about a word that can be associated with God. And the word that we want to talk about this morning that's associated with God is the word abundance, because God is a God of abundance. And we're going to be looking at some passages from the Old Testament and the New Testament this morning that refer to the idea of God being the God of abundance. Now, before we actually start doing that, I want you to be aware of something. There are a number of times when we encounter the word abundance, abundantly, something of that nature, in both the Old and the New Testaments. And a number of those different usages of these words come from different Hebrew or Greek words. They're not all the same. When it's translated by our word, abundant, sometimes, you know, we get one picture of the idea of abundant, but the Bible gives us a different picture of the idea of abundance, especially in relation to God. Now, if you have your Bible, you may want to turn along with us this morning as we think about it. Let's first go to the book of Psalms, Psalm 51 at verse number 1. Psalm 51 at verse number 1. There the psalmist writes and says, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions." There you see the idea of mercy is mentioned, but along with that idea of mercy is the idea of abundant mercy. And it's not just somebody's abundant mercy. The psalmist is writing or speaking to God in prayer, prayer that's put to music. And he speaks to God and says, it's your abundant mercy. And so we're talking about God, as we've already stated this morning, being a God of abundance. When we think about the word abundant, as is used here in this passage, this word means greatness, abundance, or multitude. Multitude. Now, if you were to look that word up in the original language, here's what you would find. It's used in passages such as the one in Genesis chapter 32, verses 11 and 12. Genesis chapter 32, verses 11 and 12, God and Jacob are having a conversation, and Jacob is begging God to deliver him from his brother Esau. If you remember the story of Jacob and Esau, Jacob stole his brother's birthright. He had to flee, and he was afraid that Esau was going to harm him. But looking at Genesis chapter 32, verses 11 and 12, Jacob pleads with God. He says, "Please deliver me from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, that he may come and attack me, the mothers with the children. But you said, I will surely do you good and make your offspring as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude." The word multitude is the same word as translated abundant here in the book of Psalm 51 at verse number 1. And so what is the point? Well, God's mercy is as abundant as the sand of the sea. That's that kind of mercy. It's abundant mercy. It's that multitude of mercy that God is willing to shed for us, to show for us. You know, sometimes I think we may get the wrong idea about God, that God is mad, that God doesn't really want me or you or anybody else to be able to come to heaven. But God is not that kind of God. God is a God of abundant mercy, a multitude, of mercy. Let's look at another passage. This one is found in Isaiah chapter 55, verse number 7. Isaiah chapter 55, verse number 7. There the writer says, "Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon." Now, I've already told you this morning that we're looking at words or passages that have different words, different shades of meaning, as it were, in regard to this abundant God. Now, we know here he's talking about pardon, but he says that he will abundantly pardon. The word used here means to increase, to make many, literally to multiply, to multiply. If you go to the book of Genesis chapter 1 at verse number 28, you remember the passage, I'm sure. It's there where the Bible says to the man that he's created, God blessed them and God said to them, "Be fruitful and" what? Multiply. Same word. Multiply. As we look at this passage and we think about God, God is willing to multiply His pardon. He has a multitude of mercy, and He's willing to multiply His pardon. Again, when I think about God, God is not one who's just looking to find something about me that He can accuse and condemn me for. God is willing to multiply His pardon. When I sin, and I do, and you do, and everybody does, and we do it regularly, unfortunately, but God is willing to multiply His pardon when that takes place. But then here's another passage, this one in the book of Romans in the New Testament, chapter 5, at verse number 17. There the Bible says, "For if because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that man, that one man, much more will be those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift, of righteousness, reign, and life through the one man, Jesus Christ." The word used here, translated abundance, has the meaning of this: a degree which is considerably in excess of some point or some implied explicit scale of extent. Another of the lexicons, those Greek dictionaries, simply define the word as superabundance. It's above the scale. It goes beyond the scale. God's grace goes beyond any scale that we can imagine in our own mind. It's superabundant. It goes above and beyond. And so God's grace is not just abundant, it's superabundant, more than you or I can ever begin to imagine. Let's look at another verse, 1 Timothy chapter 1 at verse number 14. Now, reading from the ESV, the Bible says, "And the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus." As you look at that, this word is sometimes in other passages translated abundant. If you go to the New King James Version, it's translated exceedingly abundant. But as we think about this word, this particular word translated overflowed here is used only one time in the entire New Testament. Right here in 1 Timothy chapter 1 at verse number 14. It means to over exceed in abundance. To over exceed. Now, we've already talked about this superabundance, but a different word here. This seems to go beyond that superabundance that we've already mentioned. We're talking about this morning a God of abundance. We're talking about His mercy. We're talking about His pardon. We're talking about His grace. And you see already, God is a God of abundance. But let's keep on. We're not finished with God and this God of abundance. Let's go to the book of 1 Peter chapter 1 at verse number 3. 1 Peter chapter 1 at verse number 3. Now we're back to His mercy as we see it here in the New Testament. Talked about mercy from the Old Testament. Peter's going to write about His mercy there. But in this passage, the Bible says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to His great mercy, He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." This idea that's presented here is translated in the New King James Version simply as abundant mercy. Abundant mercy. So there's our idea. But the ESV decided to translate it with the word great. The word great. You know what this word means? This word translated great or abundant here is the upper scale, the upper range of a scale. It's right up. If you've got a scale, it's right up here at the top. And that's what He says about the great mercy of God here in this passage. It's right up at the top of the scale. In the book of 2 Peter chapter 1, verse number 11, the Bible talks about an entrance that can be made abundantly. An entrance can be made abundantly into what? In that passage, the Bible says, "So an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly and to the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This high point on the scale, same word, this high point on the scale is not only talking about this idea here in 1 Peter chapter 1 at verse number 3, but also in 2 Peter chapter 1 verse number 11, being richly provided or being also provided abundantly. You know what? When I think about this, here's what I've got to understand. This abundant God is a God who made it possible for us to enter heaven with room to spare. Have you ever heard somebody say something like this? You know, if I can just barely get into heaven, I'll be fine. If I can just barely make my way there, I'll be good. Well, I understand the thought. If I can get there, I'm good. God didn't send His Son to die so I could just barely get there. God opened the door wide so that I can get there. He made it possible. He gave us room and to spare. But here's one more. Look at John chapter 10, verse number 10. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it, here's our word again, abundantly. God wants us to have life. This word, translated abundantly, pertains to a quantity so abundant as to be considerably more than one could ever expect or anticipate. You see, that's the kind of life that God wants us to have. The word means to be over and above. To be over and above. I have come that you can have life and have it abundantly. Now, we can have an abundant life here on this earth, can we not? We can have an abundant life. We can have joy. We can have peace. We can have all those things that God offers us. We can have that right here. That's an abundant life. Some people miss out on that abundant life because they are always focusing on something else other than what God really wants to give. But again, what we're looking at this morning is the idea of God, a word that can be associated with God. And over this morning so far, what we've seen is God is a God of what? Abundance. God is a God of abundance. But let's make another transition here. This abundant God that we're thinking about, talking about this morning, expects us to be workers in His kingdom. This abundant God expects us to be workers in His kingdom. Look at the book of Ephesians chapter 2 at verse number 10. Ephesians chapter 2 verse number 10. Paul writes and says, "For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Did you notice how this passage begins? We are His workmanship. Don't miss this important point. We are God's workmanship. When Paul writes that we're God's workmanship, what does he mean? What is the point that he's trying to get across to us? What is it that he's trying to get drilled into our mind? Well, this idea of workmanship comes from a word which means simply that which has been made. A product or work of a creator. That which has been made, a product or work of a creator. There are some translations that translate this passage, "We are God's craftsmanship." The ESV, "workmanship." You see, God is the craftsman. God is the designer. God is the one who actually fashioned what it is that you and I are to be. This word, translated workmanship, is used only 2 times in the New Testament. Used only 2 times. Of course, it's here in this passage that we're looking at. But where is the other passage? Well, turn to the book of Romans. Chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, and drop down, if you will, to verse number 18. Beginning in verse number 18, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppresses the truth. Now, what we need to get into our mind is in Romans chapter number 1, Paul is writing about the sinfulness of the Gentile nation. He's going to name a number of the things that they do that are wrong, that are sinful, that are evil. If you go to chapter 2, he switches gears and goes to the Jews and says, hey, you folks are really no better off than they are because this is what you do. And then when you get to chapter 3, one of the chapters that we're looking at studying tonight, he says, all right, both of you are together. Everybody's all together in this thing. And so here, remember, he's talking about the Gentiles. And he's telling us about them. We just read verse number 18. Verse 19 goes on and says, for what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. Now, God, I don't remember you ever sending a book to the Gentiles. Did he give the Jews a book? Yeah, he gave them the Ten Commandment law. They don't get that till we read in the book of Exodus, right? Chapter 20 in particular. But he says, these Gentiles, they could know. They could know about God. And they're the very early ages of the world, as we say it, God gave them enough to understand that He's a God. Now, we know this is the patriarchal dispensation. God spoke to the fathers. We understand all of that. But He said, what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. Now, God, how'd you do that? For, verse 20, His invisible attributes, namely His eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. So they're without excuse. That one long phrase there, the things that have been made, come from the same word. Back over here that we read just a moment ago from the book of Ephesians, translated workmanship. What's God's workmanship here in the book of Romans chapter 1? If you read it within its context, he's talking about the earth, the creation of the things. As you focus your attention to the skies, the sun, the moon, the stars, everything that God has placed in the universe. That is God's workmanship. And you know what? Every single one of those things, whether it be the sun, the moon, the stars, the intricate details of the earth, even bodies themselves, physical bodies themselves, every single one of them points to what? A designer. They didn't just poop, you know, and pop up and happen. Did they? That's sort of how it's portrayed in our world today. Well, it didn't just pop up and happen. Well, except for the Big Bang kind of thing, you know, that popped up. And then everything else took a long, long time to get to the intricacies that we have today. I don't know about y'all, that just don't register in my brain how that could be. But when I see it, I see design and a designer, craftsman and craftsmanship. I see the workmanship of God. And you know what? All of this craftsmanship that God put in motion, He said, it tells my story, and it does it well. Does the sun tell the story pretty well? I mean, every morning when we get up, we say it comes up. We understand how things, we rotate around the sun, the earth, you know, or revolve around the sun, the earth rotates, so forth. We understand those kinds of things. But the precision, everything works in that way. I would say, and I hope you would agree with me, that God's workmanship, craftsmanship, the things that have been made, pretty impressive. And they're always doing their job. Imagine the son. One day it decides, well, you know what? I just really and truly don't want to do what I need to do, so I'm not going to be as bright as normally I am. I'm just barely going to shine. Can't tell much difference in the day and a night with a full moon. Or the moon itself deciding, well, you know what? I'm not going to do what God designed me to do. You do know part of what God has designed the moon to do is control the tides. But what if it just barely decided it was going to lay off a day, not work, do as little as it could? You wouldn't want to be on the high tide side, would you, when it came around? Do you ever imagine in your mind any of God's creation not working abundantly? Just like the Creator was an abundant Creator. Nature doesn't take a day off. Some days we have, because of what God has set in motion, many times because of what sin has done, we have nature going into a fit, as it were. We have tornadoes and hurricanes and things like that. But even that awesome power is utterly astounding, is it not? But what is our point? What is it that we need to do? Going back to the first instance of this word workmanship found back in Ephesians chapter 2 at verse number 10. The things that we have there, we are God's workmanship created for good works. These good works that are there that God has made His craftsmanship or His workmen, workers to do, they're not things that we can do to earn our way into heaven. I hope when you hear preachers preach and they're speaking on subjects like the one that I'm talking about this morning, you're not thinking that they are talking about earning your way into heaven. You see, the works that are found in Ephesians chapter 2 at verse number 10 are the things that God has required of us. They're the requirements that God has put in place. Are we God's new creation when we become Christians? Doesn't the book of Romans chapter 6 speak about that? If we're God's new creation, doing our job should be done as well as the earth and the heavenly bodies. Shouldn't we be doing them at least to that extent? Shouldn't we? As God's new creation, I want you to understand something. We have been given much. Listen to that one more time. As God's new creation, we have been given much. We've been given God's abundant mercy, God's abundant grace, God's abundant pardon, God's abundant entrance into our new home, God's abundant life. That's what we've been given. Now, what am I doing? Luke chapter 12, verse number 48. But the one who did not work, who did what deserved a beating, will receive a light beating. Everyone to whom was much was given, of him much will be required. And from him to whom they entrusted much, they will demand the more. Required. The word means to seek, to look for. Literally, to demand. And so, in essence, the one who has done the giving, God, will be looking for, asking for, or demanding much in return. He is a God of abundance. But from those to whom He has given much, us, He will demand much. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse number 2, moreover, it's required of stewards that they be found faithful. There's our word required again. As stewards of God's word, his work on earth, God's going to be looking for, asking for, demanding much from us. And so that throws the ball back into our court. You know what? We're laborers, laborers together with God. I told you a little earlier, I was going to let you mull over old Hank. And his response to Buckley. When it comes to folks, workers like Hank, what do? They drag down their co-workers. They drag down the morale of the workplace. Their lack of effort causes them to just be a problem. Even for the one who owns the plant. And so we pick up with the story of Hank again. Buckley has tried, and Hank hasn't made any effort to make any changes. So, exasperated with Hank's attitude and lack of improvement, Mr. Fredrickson, y'all remember who I said he was, don't you? The owner of the plant, finally calls Hank into his office. And he tells him, says, Hank, I've given you a multitude of opportunities, multiple chances to change your attitude and put in the required effort. I've done that for you, but it seems like you're just bound and determined that you're going to do as little as you can, as little as you can get by with. You're going to do it your way. Hank, this kind of attitude will not cut it here. Son, you're fired. You know what Hank does? He has the audacity to begin to beg. But sir, would you not give me another chance? I need this job. I really and truly need it. Hank, I'm sorry. But you have to pick up your final check and leave. You're fired. God is a little like a factory owner. I'm not saying God is the factory owner. I'm just saying God is a little like the factory owner. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 7 through 9. So neither he who plants or he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. He who plants and he who waters are one, and each will receive his wages according to his labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. As Christians, you know what we are? We are God's fellow workers. If you read from the King James Version, it's translated in this way. We are laborers together with God. The thing about it is, God is always going to do His part, right? And God will never skimp. Why? Because God is a God of abundance. Always is. And God will never skimp. Again, throws the ball back into our court. As we labor together with God and serve His as His fellow workers on earth, what kind of job are we doing? God requires more of us than just enough to get by, doesn't He? As God's creation, He's equipped us with talents and abilities and whatever those might be. You can rest assured He's been kind to you. He knows what you're capable of because He gave you the talents. He knows that you have opportunities because He provides the opportunities. He knows what He expects because He knows what you have, that He has abundantly blessed each one of us with. And the sad thing is this. It's not just in our abilities that some do the least that they can. I want to be a Christian, but I don't want to be much of one. I just want to barely be one. Bare minimum. Just a little bit. Problem is, it's just like Hank with his coworkers. That attitude is also on full display for your brothers and sisters in Christ and people in the world. One last passage before we quit. 1 Corinthians 15, verse number 58. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. The word abounding is the verb form of the adverb that we encountered in John chapter 10, verse number 10. That word abundant. Abundant life. You see, as we close this lesson, God doesn't expect us to be Hank. God expects from us the same kind of effort as the life He has provided for us, an abundant life, abounding in the work of the Lord. I guess the easiest way to ask it this morning is this. Is your name Hank when it comes to your living as a Christian? Is it Hank? Now, Hank's not a bad name. We just chose that one to use. But the idea is this. Do we have the attitude that we do just enough? We'll test the limits. We'll be like a small child, just to see how close we can get to the edge. Or are we more like our Father who's in heaven? Abundant in our service to Him. Just as He has abundantly blessed us. Maybe you need to examine your own life today to see where you stand. Maybe you've never become a Christian. You need to enter into that abundant life. Be a partaker of the mercy and the grace of God and that pardon that God is wanting to offer us and offer it abundantly. Maybe you need to respond to the gospel and be baptized for the remission of your sins. Maybe you're here and there's something that you need to make right with your God, with the church. We pray with you and for you. If you need to respond, come right now as we stand and as we sing.
Jesus is tenderly calling me home. Yeah.
in remembrance. On this Lord's Day, we assemble around the table of the Lord. Happy hearts are made to tremble when we hear His blessed word. We recall His broken body as we look upon this bread. Give ye thanks, divide and eat it in my memory, He said. Let us give thanks for the loaf. Father, we're so thankful that you have provided a way for us to have forgiveness of sin. As we eat this bread, let us remember our Savior, Jesus Christ, who sacrificed His body upon that cross. And it's in His name we pray. Amen. And this crimson cup reminds us of that bread seen long ago. When He died in pain and anguish, there His blood was made to flow. There in agony He suffered on the cross for you and me. Now upon the throne, He's reigning, blessed Lamb of Calvary. Our Father, we thank you for this cup. It represents our Savior's precious blood that He shed. He did this that mankind might have a renewed relationship with you. We're so thankful. And as we drink this cup, let us remember and not forget the price that He paid. And in His name we pray. Amen. Thanks to God for such a Savior, now enthroned in heaven above. Thanks for this exalted favor, blessed memorial of His love. We also need to remember that we're commanded to contribute, give back to the Lord on the first day of the week. I don't know everyone's condition, but I know that I've been truly blessed, not only to have a Savior, but to have a goodly portion of this world's goods. And I'm thankful. Let us give thanks for our blessings. Our Father, you bless us so much. Not only that you bless us spiritually, you also bless us materially. And at this time, we want to thank you for that. And let us not forget that we have an obligation to you and to your church, that we might carry the good news forward. And that we pray that each one will give liberally. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Grant, especially stepping in at the last minute. Thank you, Ed. Thank you, Tommy. Thank you, Terry, who will be coming forward in just a moment to lead us in our closing prayer. And Mark, thank you very much for the lesson of the hour. It's probably a good idea to keep Kelly and Megan in your thoughts and your prayers, especially Megan and the baby. Today may be the day, I don't know for sure, we don't know, but that's where they're at this time.
Born at 9:27.
All right, already been born, 9:27. How much?
7 pounds.
7 pounds. All right, congratulations to Kelly and Megan. Keep them in your prayers. Remember those, I hope you've picked up a bulletin. If you have not done so, make sure that you do so before you exit the building. Remember those that are listed in the bulletin, those that have been, names that have been sent out via text, and keep them in mind. You had the names from last Sunday there back in the bulletin. Remember Porter Archibald, this is a friend of Easton Banks who's going to start chemo. And also Wayne Stebbin, the brother of Ryan Stebbin, who will be having surgery, heart surgery, this coming Wednesday. Again, let me say thank you so very much for being here this morning. We appreciate it. I hope you have planned or are planning, if you haven't already made plans, planning to stay after the dismissal prayer for class. That will be in just a few moments. I'm going to finish up. And after I do so, Rick's going to come up here just in just a second and has something to say. And then Grant will lead us in our closing song, then Terry in our closing prayer.
There's coming a day when the light shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye, all the disease forevermore, all that happy golden shore, what a day
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, just thank you for this day you've given us, Lord, to be in your house and to uplift you in songs and praise. And Lord, just to be able to grow in your word and witness to other people about your word, Lord, to bring souls to you. And Lord, just be with Kelly and Megan and Miller as they welcome Sully into the world. Lord, just be with them and watch over them. And also be the one that has been mentioned here on our prayer list, Lord. Be the one who's starting chemo. Be with them and comfort them. And Lord, also be with the ones who's lost loved one this week. Lord, just be with them and our family and comfort them. And Lord, just forgive us, we'll pray, fail you, Lord, and just watch over us and protect us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.